Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you all for today's e-conference on role of R&D in making chemical industry Atmanirbhar, organized by Indian Chemical News. Myself, Praveen Prashant, editor, Indian Chemical News, will be your host and moderator for today's e-conference. Yesterday, there was a very important announcement made by Prime Minister Narendra Modi while speaking at a global investor roundtable. He talked about Atmanirbhar. He said, Atmanirbhar is not just a vision, but a well-planned economic strategy. He stressed that it is a strategy that aims to use the capabilities of India's businesses and skills of its workers to make India into a global manufacturing powerhouse. Investors are moving towards companies which have a high environmental, social, and governance score. He's talking about ESG, environmental, social, and governance score. For making India into a global manufacturing powerhouse, the chemical vertical will play a bigger role. And if you look at the overall industry dynamics of 160 billion growing at 100 basis points, faster than India's GDP, and expected to double its size to reach 300 billion by 2025. And all this can happen only when we do our R&D bit in a significant way. If we are able to do that, we might even move beyond $300 billion. But, and that the whole seminar is all about how we can achieve that number with the small bit of R&D that we plan to do. Next. So if you see the key discussion points for today, these are the key discussion points: reasons for low investment, creating awareness about the benefits of R&D, creation of R&D fund, giving direct support to MSMEs for R&D, developing an institutional framework for R&D, enhancing Indian inventorship of patents. Next slide. If you see, we have got an excellent mix of speakers from academia, R&D labs, Indian MNCs, as well as MNCs. And majority of them are either professors and doctors, very eminent panel. And I would like to thank each one of them for sparing time for ICL and be available for this event for the next 90 minutes. We have with us Professor Anirudh B. Pandit, Vice Chancellor, Institute of Chemical Technology, Professor Madhu Vinjamur, Head Department of Chemical Engineering, IIT Bombay, Dr. Komu Nagaya, Chief Scientist and Head CSIR, IICT, Professor Dr. R.K. Khandal, President R&D India Glycols, Dr. Pramod Kumbar, President and CTO Raj Industries, Rahul Tikku, Managing Director South Asia Huntsman, Dr. Mayuk G. Varudekar, Senior VP R&D Fine Organic Industries, Vinod Parimal, Regional President Evonik, Dr. Manoj Surwade, Sales Development Manager, Chemical and Energy Market, HLH. So now let me, what we are doing is we are also having something for the delegates. And I would request my colleague Yogesh Joshi, who is having a birthday today, to talk about the IC and Play and Win contest. And he would be the one who would be conducting this contest during the course of the webinar. So over to Yogesh Joshi.
Thanks. And welcome everyone to this interesting, you know, series of e-conferences that ICN has been organizing since the last 3 months. And the role which I am going to play is primarily of a moderator come a host for this particular special initiative called ICN Play and Win Contest. So what we realize, you know, let me give you a short background while I'll try to keep myself limited so that, you know, I don't distract your key discussions, which are the main highlight of the panel session today. So what we realized was that, you know, it was more of a panel session wherein the interaction was happening. And while the audience had the option of, you know, sharing their suggestion or pointers through chat and question and answers, we realized that the audience equally plays an important role in the whole, you know, game of this particular session. So keeping that in mind, we decided that we should try to get our audience also excited equally as the panelists which are there in the session. And keeping that in mind, we decided to launch this special play and win contest, which will essentially be consisting of a few questions, generic questions, one-liners, with obviously the answers also, you know, in the clues of presentations which will be presented during the course of the day, and along with a couple of GK based questions on chemical and the petrochemical industry. Some of the, you know, housekeeping pointers are already flashing in front of your slides. So the idea is that I'll be asking, posing questions in the middle of the session. And the audience primarily has to answer, you know, give their responses via only the chat window. Please note, the answers needs to be responded only via the chat window and not through the question and answer window. And the correct answer, you know, the person who responds first with the correct answer will be, you know, eligible for the first prize winner of that particular question. So like this, we will have these set of questions asked between the sessions. And the winners will be announced at the end of the session, which is at 4:30 p.m. So we will request, you know, all the winners, we will be flashing their names on the chat window as well as announcing their names in between the sessions. But the request is that they should hang on till the last of the session so that, you know, they formally collect the prizes as well from us today itself. Thank you. And this is all from my side. And I, you know, again, request my colleague Praveen to take over the proceedings from here. Thanks.
Thank you, Yogesh. So the only important announcement is whatever questions that are being asked by Yogesh, please type the answers in the chat window. Don't put the answers in the Q&A section, then you would be disqualified. Now, since we have an eminent panel, without wasting any time, I would ask Dr. Manoj Surwade, Sales Development Manager, Chemical and Energy Market, Agilent, to give his presentation. I request him, so if we can finish it in 6 minutes time, and if you can share the screen so that Dr. Manoj Surwade can begin his presentation. Over to Dr. Manoj Surwade.
Thank you, Mr. Praveen. Is my screen visible?
Yeah, it's visible. Make it full
screen. Yeah. Let me make it full screen. Okay. Thank you, participants, and all the respected speakers and panelists. On behalf of Agilent Technology, I personally would like to thank Indian Chemical News for inviting us and providing platform to present our portfolio at this esteemed e-conference. Those who are... Just a minute. Those who are new to Agilent Technologies, for them, let me take you through our Agilent profile. So Agilent Technology Private Limited is a manufacturer and solution provider of analytical instruments serving various industries like pharma, chemical, energy, food, environment, and so on. We are present in almost around 110 countries across the globe with more than 16,000 employees and serving around 10 lakhs customers across the globe. We have been also awarded the best company to contribute and serve our customers and one of the best place to work for. As I mentioned earlier, we are not only manufacturing company, but also solution provider to many industries, including chemical and energy sector. Our world-class state-of-the-art instruments are used across the industry as a R&D tool to contribute results at international standards, as well as addressing and meeting the regulations requirement at international level. Just for information, we worked around the world serving more than 265,000 labs in all the vital industries. Now, the most important part. Very recently, Government of India has a very ambitious plan to focus and grow Indian chemical sector. It is their key initiative, of course, which can contribute to grow to the GDP of our country. And as Praveenji has mentioned, that the government has a vision to grow this particular size of industry from $178 billion to $300 billion by 2025. This is what the ambitions of our Indian government is, and they have been supporting us. So this market is expecting double-digit growth also for the agrochemicals also and for the specialty chemicals. Government of India is supporting this ambitious plan by providing incentives, a one-window approval to encourage new setups and the small and medium entrepreneurs. Recently, government has also urged Indian chemical giants to focus on the new agriculture molecules to support the farmers and to have a less dependency on other countries, including China. So this is one of the messages they are given. Now, how Agilent can contribute to the Atmanirbhar Bharat initiative? So yes, we are not new to this industry. First of all, we have been supporting this industry for many decades. And we at Agilent Technologies are equally contributing to this novel initiative of government to grow chemical and energy market by providing R&D tools and solutions meeting international standards. Our ready-to-set solutions to address various sub-segments in CNE sectors are already in action across the pan India. We are partners with major chemical giants. We are already playing important role in growing chemical engineering and providing solutions to address sub-market like specialty chemicals or basic chemicals or the polymers and the materials. Instruments including the raw materials, example, the additives, surfactants and so forth. Our recent solution for the analysis of alcohol in hand sanitizers using gas chromatography has been benefited many labs across the country during the pandemic time. We are also supporting analysis of pharma intermediates and healthcare products using HPLC solutions. Our elemental solutions for analysis of toxic metals in toys or analysis of biofertilizers or fertilizers using ICP, AAS or NP has served and provided ready-made solutions to the chemical giants as well as to the small and medium entrepreneurs. In the nutshell, our state-of-art instruments like chromatography for organics, molecular spectroscopy for inorganics, serves as a quality control and R&D tool to address various applications across the chemical industry. Even in this pandemic situation, we have provided a lot of analytical solutions within the with the various applications, for example, hand sanitizer, as I mentioned, or analysis of PPE kit and healthcare sectors. Our presence in India, we have three centers of excellence across India, one in Mumbai, Bangalore, and one is in Manesar, that is in North. We altogether has 500 plus employees with 50 plus dedicated application team working for a center of excellence. A center of excellence, we provide education to our...
So thank you, Dr. Manoj. Now I will request Professor Dr. R.K. Khandal, who has worked both in academia as well as presently working in industry. And I would request you to talk about the technology gap due to which industries cannot manufacture some of the high price products and how it needs to be addressed. So over to Professor Dr. R.K. Khandal.
Thank you, Engineer Praveen Prashant ji. Pranam, Sare, Sabhi, all the eminent panelists, Professor Pandit, Professor Moon, Dr. Nariya, Dr. Tikku, Dr. Paremal, Dr. Surbade, Dr. Varvarekar, Professor Engineer Praveen Prashant, Dr. Yogesh, and Dr. Kumba. Coming specific to the question that you have asked, I have 2-3 things to submit. And maybe that can be the base for discussion further. First and foremost point is, this is a brilliant idea that our Prime Minister has said that we should be Atmanirbhar. And this is one lesson that all of us have learned, if nothing else, from this COVID-19. Unless we are Atmanirbhar, we will never be able to grow. The example is drugs and pharma industry. In the 80s, I have seen the MSME, SMEs, in drug and pharma industry came up for providing the key starting materials. and APIs. Suddenly, during the 85-86, the Chinese materials came with a very cheap cost, and completely the key starting material company which had started working, doing the production, they were shut down because they could not compete. The API manufacturers were very happy that they were able to get cheap products from China. Suddenly, in a matter of 1 or 2 years, the APIs started coming from China with a cheaper cost. So the bulk drug manufacturers preferred to buy from China rather than taking it locally. At the end of the day, in just 10 to 15 years' time, all our KSM manufacturers, all our API manufacturers were closed down, and our bulk drug industry became completely dependent on import from China. Today, the scenario is that 70 to 75% of our KSM and API requirement is sourced from China. Recently, Government of India banned most of the apps from China. And what China did, about 2 weeks ago, they have raised the prices of all the KSM and APIs. And we have to bear the burden. What I'm trying to say is that unless we are Atmanirbhar, we cannot say we are number one in the world of supplying drugs and pharma. We cannot say that we are number one in chemical and petrochemical industry. This is point number one. Point number two, our name of our ministry is Chemicals and Petrochemicals. I always say this and I repeat this here. When God does not give you something below the earth, it always blesses you above the earth. That means gives you brain. We Indians are brainy. God did not give us something below the earth, that means petroleum crude. We missed out on that. But the countries which got the blessings of God in terms of petroleum below the earth, they hardly had something above the earth. So we are everywhere sending our human resources to manage all crude refineries, petrochemicals, etc., etc. But the point which I want to make here is that we have had a strong base of renewable chemicals. Now, I work for a company which is one of its kind in the world. 30 years ago, the management took a decision that we will make monoethylene glycol, a simple molecule, which is a major raw material for making polyester, the complete polyester industry. And you know, in the world 30 years ago, we were nowhere. India Glycol started manufacturing MEG. Everybody used to raise eyebrows, including Reliance, because the capacity of Reliance were anyway 10 times, 20 times, 30 times more than that of Indian Glycols. All Chinese, Japanese, when we used to discuss about technology, they used to laugh at India Glycol's visionary founder, who said we will be Atmanirbhar from day one. Because around India Glycols, there are farmers of sugar, cane sugar. There are sugar industry, we will get molasses and we will make energy from this. Further to this, then they went into ethylene oxide manufacturing, the only plant in the world, first of its kind. And even today, the kind of scale at which it manufactures ethylene oxide and ethylene oxide condensates, the perfect example of making India, perfect example of being Atmanirbhar. The third point I want to make here is that for everything that if we have to depend for a route which is petrochemical, we will never be able to get competitive. Now the point which I want to make here, 2-3 points which I just want to leave as a teasing point. We have today become the net exporter of formaldehyde. We are today exporting pentaerythritol, but we are importing DCDA, a simple molecule from which we manufacture all the drugs of diabetes. We don't manufacture DCDA. And because we don't manufacture DCDA, we are not able to manufacture melamine. Now, thanks to the government of Gujarat, the central government, which had set up a plant of 40,000 tons of melamine, the requirement is 80,000 tons. Now, the point I want to make here is that our economy in the times to come has to be driven by methanol, has to be driven by ethanol. I just give you one or two indicators of it. an organization called Uniniverse has taken a decision that they will manufacture all their detergents, they will manufacture all their cosmetics and home care products based on renewable chemicals. And you know who is the partner of Uniniverse for that? It is India Glycols. Because they will replace LAB. Their plans is that in next 20 years, $1.3 billion business will be based on renewable chemicals. The name of our ministry is Chemicals and Petrochemicals. We do not even have a renewable chemical, the term renewable chemical, if you pick up the latest report of Chemical and Petrochemicals. You pick up the report published in 2019 by Chemical and Petrochemicals. You search for renewable chemicals, you will not find it there. The only term you get is renewable energy, not renewable chemical. So we have become partner with Uniniverse to make these products. The point which I want to tell you is we have before us the technology which can convert the agri waste, which is not the feeder, which is not feed. See, you can't take agri waste, which is agriculture waste, used as a feeder. I'm talking about agriculture waste, which is being burnt. So why don't we tie up at national level? See, look at this scheme of chemical and petrochemicals, Atmanirbhar scheme. Nowhere it talks about technology. It talks about package for the industry. It talks about PLI, product link incentive. We should talk about technology. In the year 2014, just before Modiji came into power, the 2012-2017 five-year plan, that time it was planning commission, they had made a base paper, and I would request all the experts and all those who are listening to me, they should look for that base paper. It clearly talks about what all is to be done to make this country become 226 billion by the year 2018. Now remember, in the 2018, when Nirmala Sitharamanji was minister, she made a statement, we will achieve this by 2020. We have not yet achieved. We are still close, we are just about to close to 200. And now we are saying, CII is saying, we will achieve 305 in the next 5 years. We are far, far behind in time. The last point I want to make is, the decisions taken, the decision support system is not technology driven. It's finance driven. The Niti Aayog is made different from Planning Commission, but it is run the same way as it was being run there. I wish some technology leaders were running Niti Aayog. Give you an example. Suppose a decision is taken by Green Tribunal. They say convert all the plants at zero liquid discharge plant. They just don't bother that the plants cannot, with this kind of facilitation by the government. The government considers the manufacturing units only for earning taxes, etc. If GNT, this Green Tribunal takes a decision that all plants be zero liquid discharge, I think in the Atmanirbhar paper, that should have been the first thing by government. The government of India builds expressways, builds highways, builds airports. All this is being built. I think this is the time. Prashantji, it is very good initiative ICR has taken. I really appreciate also the sponsor, Agilent. Their equipment will certainly be sold, provided we compete with China and we compete with Europe and US. And we manufacture these products more here. Melamine, we should have put up the capacity of 80,000 tons rather than 40,000. We are still importing chemicals based on ethylene oxide. The product linked incentive should be given only to renewable chemicals. If in future we want to be Atmanirbhar, these are the pointers I thought. And more points I'll be able to supplement when the day goes on. But I thought the biggest point that the government should be facilitator. It should provide at a common point all the utilities. Take the effluent and convert it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Dr. Khandal. Now I would request, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to balance the academia and the industry at the same time. So now I will take one person from the academia. Professor Anirudh B. Pandit. He is recognized for PhD in Chemical Engineering, Research Guide for PhD in Chemical Engineering, Bioprocess Technology, and Green Technology. So, sir, my first question to you is, R&D investments in the country is not at par with US, European Union, or China. Knowing the fact that we will not be at par for some time more. How do we take benefit from whatever we have and leverage that and move fast? So over to Professor Pandit.
Thank you, Praveen. And I think I have got 2 points to make, and I totally and completely agree with Dr. Khandal. Essentially, what he talked about was incentivizing not the finance, but incentivizing the technologies. The kind of viability gap funding, which the government has started with the petrochemical sectors, is an excellent initiative to try out new technologies, which are indigenous technologies, and how if a company wants to take up these technologies, initially these technologies will be producing product at a much higher cost. And that is where the government incentivizes this particular technology, which would be a requirement. Now, coming back to your basic question of whether the funding is enough or not, if you ask me, then in at least in chemical and chemical technology sector, funding is enough. The only problem is funding is not prioritized. One. Second, the output coming from that particular funding is not properly monitored. For us to be able to monitor the utility of that particular funding in terms of products and processes, it cannot be done by academicians. The outcome of the funding, if an academician is going to judge it, he is going to judge it in terms of what are going to be the publications, in which journals these publications have appeared, what is the impact factor of these journals, and they will pat their own back and stating that I have published so much. Look, my the project proposal and the funding which I received from the government has been put to use. India is not, unfortunately, in a such a positive or a such a luxurious position to use and do blue sky research and focus on only publications. The accountability in terms of when a project proposal is given, let's say to DST or DBT or DAE or any of these funding agencies, including Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers, Ministry of Environment and Forests, each of these funding agencies have got specific earmarked money for R&D. And you will find the quality of the proposals which are coming for funding are needs a lot to be desired. You will find that these are unfocused proposals. The deliverables are not really correctly assessed or predicted. Of course, research is an activity with a lot of uncertainty. But since the research is based on the fundamental principles of physics, chemistry, mathematics, biology, which have not changed, whether you have understood this principle and are able to translate that principles in the form of viable, when I say viable, not only technically viable, but economically viable processes or products needs to be looked at. So if I want to answer your question in short, whether the funding is enough or not, if you ask me, funding is enough, but it needs to be prioritized. And accountability for that particular funding needs to be improved significantly. Related to certain specific areas, if you consider areas which are emerging areas in the area of chemicals and fertilizers, banning 53 APIs could be one activity which the government did. But to support that particular activity, you can't say from tomorrow, as correctly pointed out by Dr. Khandal, that you stopped it because this is a zero discharge. And alternatives need to be available. And that is why you should, what you should do is incentivize the preparation of alternatives first, have the deliverables ready, and then you can penalize the cheap import of the chemicals or cheap import of the technologies. Now, what we are complaining about China, in 70s and 80s, we did exactly the same thing to the Indian, to the European dyestuff industry. We started producing dyestuff at such throwaway prices without following any environmental norms. And in 10 years' time, European dye and intermediate industry was completely wiped out. The same thing happened to us when China came into picture. China started wiping, but as correctly pointed out by Dr. Kandal, we have something out here which we learned to use, and from 2 to 3% of the reduced market of dyes and intermediate, we have now jumped back again to 14 and 15%, and I'm sure many will, this will increase further. Indians have been very, very business minded, and what they need to look at is what are the opportunities for business, and they can find opportunities in many. When Chinese started squeezing their own companies for environmental concern and started closing down the industries, Indians imported the Chinese plants lock, stock and barrel. They improved upon it and then started producing at throwaway prices. So opportunities are there, but the accountability has to be there. This is what I would submit at this stage. And if you have any further questions or queries, I'll be more than happy to answer.
Thank you, Professor Pandit. I think beautifully you have put it to all our panelists, and that prioritization needs to be done. I would now request Yogesh Joshi, my colleague, to ask the first question, and then we will come to Dr. Manoj. Dr. Manoj, yes, for and he will focus on what are the future trends in the chemical industry. So over to Yogesh Joshi for the first question.
Yogesh, you're on the mute, I think.
Sorry. Yeah. Let me start with my request is the audience should listen to the question very carefully, and after listening the question, ensure that they type their answers in the chat window only. So the question goes here: from where did Mukesh Ambani get his BE degree in chemical engineering? So over the hint is, you just heard two presentations, like it was one and half kind. One was from Agilent, and then other one was from Mr. Pandit. The clue is hidden. The answer of this, the clue of this answer is hidden in these two presentations. So please feel free to respond via the chat window. Thanks. Over to Praveen.
Thanks, Yogesh.
Hello, Praveen. Should we?
Thanks, Yogesh. Now, Dr. Manoj, you have joined. Yeah, over.
Sure.
To you, sir.
Thank you. So yes, a lot of new trends are expected in the future for CN industry. So if I consider new trends with respect to analytical industry, so yes, I can see a major trend that will be see the two different trends we can see over here. One is an increase in the R&D centers or the center of excellence for the CN industry. And second might be the data integrity or data security. So the reason is that because in future, definitely when we are talking about growing the business from 178 billion to 300 billions by 2025, definitely a lot of regulations, compliance that will be driven the process. The process will become stringent. There will be a lot of environmental regulations, health and human health regulations will be implicated. That will push this CNE or a chemical industry process to have a stringent process. To just have the stringent process and to follow the standards, definitely they have to invest a lot of money in their R&D centers. So yes, future trend, we will be seeing a lot of R&D centers coming up. We will be seeing the streamlined project kind of a process with a least discharge, taking care of environment. So that is a one trend which we may see in the future. Second is the data integrity and data security. Yes, that will also be the second trend which will be followed in chemical industry. Right now, pharmaceutical industry is having that trend where people have been very compliance oriented and they're just taking care of their data integrity. But then the second trend is also we may be seeing in the industry. If you see, If you are just concerned about agile and technology, so we are ready to address both these future trends. We have the solutions there to support the R&D centers, right from the entry level instrument to a very sophisticated instruments. We are there to give you a solution, not only boxes or instruments, but we will be just providing you the complete solutions. We are ready. We have a ready-made solution to help your R&D processes. Even we do also have a server-based solutions where we can take care of your data in the future. So yes, these are the two different trends which we might see with respect to analytical industry. Over to you, Pravinji.
Thank you, Dr. Prabhu. Thank you, Dr. Pramod, for the trends part of it. Now I would request Dr. Pramod Kumar, President and CTO of Praj Industries, if he can talk about what we are not making and what would be the strategy for renewable and biochemicals. So over to Dr. Pramod Kumar.
Good afternoon, all. and thanks. ICN for inviting me for this interaction. As you said, I come from petrochemical industry. I worked in petrochemical industry for 25 years. And then I joined Praj Industries, which was mainly related to biotechnology or biofuels and biochemicals. So that was a major change that I did 8-9 years ago. And during the last 25 years that I spent in petrochemical industry, starting my job at Ardelia Chemicals and then the work for GE Plastics and then again SI Group. There are a number of things that stuck me in 25 years and that will still remain the same. I haven't changed much. There are certain chemicals where India doesn't have any presence at all, even in petrochemical side. Like acrylic acid, we don't make any acrylic acid today. There is a recent announcement that was made by BPCL, I think, to make acrylic acid. That has come after a long time. So there are a number of chemicals, methyl ethyl ketone or solvents, number of other chemicals. Propylene glycol was very small. So number of chemicals that we make, there are maybe hundreds of chemicals that still we don't make. And I think if you want to become Atmanirbhar, we need to have all these chemicals to be first, even though it's from petrochemical route, should be made in India. And that's the challenge that chemical industry has to take up now. And it's good to see that there are a number of these are being now announced, plants are being announced in that way because of availability of raw material from the refineries. And the refineries taking interest in putting these petrochemical plants. To just talk about renewable chemicals and materials, Praj, as in Praj, is what we call is we are in agro processing. As Dr. Khandal mentioned, we don't have petrol or fossil fuels from underground, but what we have is a lot of over the ground crops, biomass, carbohydrates, sugars. We have enough of sugars. We are actually glut of sugar now. So that's one feedstock that Praj has been interested in for last 30 years. And we are working very seriously on this. So we started with bioethanol. Last 30 years, we are supplying plants, technology, engineering in bioethanol, which is of course goes in blending mainly now because of the policies that government of India has pushed in. What we started 12 years back with our new R&D center in Pune to make renewable chemicals starting from carbohydrates or biomass-based sugars. And in that way, we developed some of the technologies which were unique in the last 5 years. And probably we are one of the few companies in this area which spends about 2% of its revenue on R&D, which is a big number for a company of our size that we spent. And it's a unique center where we have more focus on microbiology or biology side, part of chemical side also. We spend money on this, developing these renewable chemicals, as Dr. Khandal said, and I'm very happy that he's opened this session on this renewable chemicals part. So we started with biofuels and we are changing our gears now into biochemicals. Actually, this year, 4 months back, we launched a renewable chemicals and materials platform called BioPrism. Where we say that we'll convert all biomass or carbohydrate sugars to different chemicals and materials, either by bioprocesses or chemical catalytic processes. So we are not stuck on that everything should be made by biology, but we can do by chemistry also. And there are a number of companies in US and Europe have taken lead in this area already, particularly on the renewable chemical space. The first renewable polymer that was made by DuPont maybe 20 years back, Sorona, which is a PTT, polytetraphthalate. It took them almost 15 years to make that plant successful. So it's going to be a game of patience. Renewable, if people think that renewable chemicals will be at the same price at the fossil fuel price, particularly in the commodities, not going to happen because everything depends on your conversion cost or the raw material price. Fossil fuels are denser fuels and your cheaper avenues. The biomaterials are depend on the agroeconomy. So that needs to be holistically seen as how I can help the farming community to grow, to paying them more for their all the feedstock. So it's not using only the grain or main product, but how we can convert the biomass residues, everything over the soil should convert it to some useful product. That's the major, that's what we are working. The government of India has taken a remarkable job in last 6-7 years for the biofuels. Like they have given wood price ethanol for blending on the first generation feedstocks. Also, they have given good funding, very viable gap funding for bioethanol produced from second generation feedstocks. The thing is that for renewable chemicals, they haven't even touched how they are going to deal with this topic, which is very important. Unless and until the government takes lead, at least to support this renewable chemicals industry, it's going to be very difficult to make forays into that. And as you see, the plastic is a big issue. We have the plastic that goes into the sea, coming into the food chain. The only way to avoid that is either recycle the plastic, that's happening in small way, but making biodegradable plastic or biocompostable plastic is the only way that is there, and you can make it from all sugars. So the major focus, the polylactic acid plant, after 10 years, we have two big plants. The one was by Cargill NatureWorks in US. The other one was by Corbion Total. Both of them are now sold out. So almost 350-400,000 tons of polylactic acid that is made worldwide is completely sold out today. So as you can see, in the last 3 years, this has happened because of the push on the making bioplastics. And India is nowhere in the picture. We are nowhere in bioplastics or any biodegradable. We don't even think of that. And that's what where Praj is focusing. We hope that our first molecule polymer will come in 2024. We hope to build first our polymer, biopolymer plant in 2024 with our production partners. So that's what I have to say. Thank you. If you have any questions, I can take that.
The first molecule will come into picture. Now I request Dr. Gomu Nagaya from CSIR IICT. He's a preeminent natural product organic chemist of India, and I would request him to talk on the role of universities and institutes in India for Atmanirbhar Bharat and how we can develop an institutional framework for R&D. So over to Dr. Nagaya.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Praveen ji. Thank you very much. You have given opportunity at the outset. I am very thankful to the organizers and distinguished professors and the galaxy scientists. So it is good afternoon to all. So today I am going to talk on role of Indian industries to making a chemical and drug industries Atmanirbhar. The most important idea of our Prime Minister to a bigger economy is goal from this in the manufacturing sector, 16% GDP to we want to do by 2020 GDP. So most important, what is our drug industry silver linings? silver lining about drug Indian drug industry is means India is exporting drugs for 3.9 billion. There is no doubt at all, and they are exporting all hepatitis C or the lepidavir or HIV and all these things. So what government has introduced for the measure to like the production linked incentives. This is most important from Indian industries who are making for Atmanirbhar. So government want to go into incentives for the own who are making those companies. So that is one. And in Hyderabad itself, several drug companies are manufacturing push toward the exporting. This is the achievement of Atmanirbhar Bharat or self-reliant. So our drug industry is concentrating on export generic only rather than for Indian market. So now I am going to talk about the role of the chemical and drug industry for Atmanirbhar Bharat. So the first step to achieve the Atmanirbhar Bharat, so basic chemicals like so dimethyl permanganate, dimethyl melanate or DHF, etc., or reagent like sodium borate, etc., etc., should be manufactured from Indian chemical industries instead of importing from China itself. So we should have the Atmanirbhar Bharat that is lacking in Indian chemical industry. Our contention is we should manufacture without importing from China. So India need to set up a stockpile of drug intermediates, very necessary to insulate the nations against the external factors like pandemic, COVID-19, or trade wars, or the natural disasters. So we need manufacturers' plants for all the chemicals used in the drug industry. The drug industry need to be insulated from the traps, the tariffs or high demands where necessary. So the essential drugs, particularly the one used for the against for flu or tuberculosis and other infectional diseases, have to be manufactured based on the projections based out of epidemiological projections. So India also need to be invested in research chemical engineers. There are so many chemical engineers in India and industrial engineers to help to design, scale up the manufacturing as far as growing needs. So here is the most important, not only chemists, these are really the chemical engineers and the industrial engineers' role is most important. India import from China basic chemicals to advanced drug intermediates from China is 10 to 12 steps. And what our drug industry doing, it just perform the synthesis of the last two steps to get the drug, that is N-2 synthesis. So even China supplies provide process for the even last step also. So this we don't want. We want from Atmanirbhar. So we don't, once again, I say that the turnover and production of drug in India is not due to the R&D of efforts of Indian drug industry, but courtesy of China. So this we don't want. Prime Minister, don't want for courtesy of China. We have to make our own. Our professors, our institute to make our own. So however, how many crores of the rupees these drug companies are spending to import basic chemicals to advanced drug intermediate from China? This information could not be get anywhere. So I want to say, there are at least 15,000 plus qualified BSc's, MSc's or PhD's who are chemical engineers are in R&D and production of the pharmaceutical with so much manpower. Majority of them in R&D are expected to work on new drug discovery. However, no such efforts are visible in India. So you have to make our own. That is most important. I want to trace, you make from basic chemicals, you make from the fine chemicals, you are direct intermediates. In India, there are more than 100 or 200 big companies are there. What I requesting you to the big companies, make for the each company 10 intermediates. That is enough for to self supply 100 into 1000 basic chemicals we will manufacture here. So here is the effort to made from the reduce the import component of the basic drugs and fine chemicals like substituted indoles, quinolones, and pyridines, especially from China. Therefore, it is essential to drug industry to concentrate basic chemicals, chemical and final product to formulation. Here is the most important, I want to say, stress one point. The MSME role is negligible, marginal, because they have the understanding with big industries to manufacture few chemicals like a cyanopyridine or aminopyridine. So as far as
Dr. Nagaya, we will come to the MSME point in the second track.
Okay. Now I am going to roll up universities in institutes in India, Atmanirbhar Bharat. In university level, research pantera in chemistry to talk, and for this purpose the library first should be well equipped. There is library is a temple, so all wherever the library like a temple, so it is should also laboratory synthesis from the conventional and new reactions need to be industry oriented syllabus in the universities. So this is the, I am requesting the university professor make from the industrial oriented syllabus conventional reactions. So universities and institutes need to be take initiate to on all the aspect of the pharma sector discussed above, correct imbalances of pharma sector, develop technology for substitutions, and above all the focus need to be drug discovery, even me too drugs also welcome for the national institutions. What one is professor telling, we are taking the our vice chancellor telling, we are taking funds, sir, we are publishing the, no, that is not. You make known things first, you make the known things me too drugs. So that is most essential for the institutions and universities. So for this, from the national institute and welcome point and national institutes with the intervention of the DST, DST must think, DBT must think, and all who are funding to think about the Atmanirbhar Bharat, how Atmanirbhar Bharat for the universities. And so this is most important. Finally, what I want to do, conclusion, India need to be set up a stock. Stockpile drug intermediate to insulate the nations against this pandemic things. And we have achieved Atmanirbhar Bharat. Focus should be given for the manufacturers, basic chemicals, fine chemicals, and advanced drug intermediates. In big chemical industry, manufacture basic chemicals, at least 10 products. Every big company should manufacture for the self-reliance or the Atmanirbhar Bharat. That is I am. And one more point, what I wanted to say. India also need to invest to research and chemical engineers and industrial engineers to help the design and scale up the manufacturing as for the growing needs. So better to use from the Indian industries for the who are the chemical engineers or industrial engineers to achieve this objective. Indian drug manufacturer institutes or universities should be association and discuss how to achieve this Atmanirbhar Bharat from basic chemical to finished product. So I am touching in Atma this in my things only with respect to drug only. So however, the same problems are there from the manufacturing polymers and paints and agrochemicals and pesticides. So what I want to do, last point, what I want to say, all the subsidies of the new Atmanirbhar Bharat may be given. In fact, any encouragement to financial or chemical by government to be given to those who have the achieved self-sufficient, not uniform to all the industries. I am requesting the government better to give who are doing from the Atmanirbhar, who each company is doing, give subsidies to those companies. So likewise, encouragement of subsidies are any concessions are only in who they achieve the Atmanirbhar Bharat to support.
Thank you, Dr. Nagaya. We will come back to you. I think you are very passionate about Atmanirbhar Bharat, and with passionate people, we will definitely see things moving in that direction. We will come back to you, sir.
Only one thing. What I want to say, because we are working, we are taking. So you have to work for Indian growth. You have to work from the that is in my mind. You are Indians. You have to work from the Atmanirbhar. That's okay.
Thank you, sir. Now I would request Rahul Tikku from Huntsman. Sir, if you can talk about how do we create a Silicon Valley ecosystem in Indian chemical industry. Silicon Valley is very popular, has done pretty well in yester years. Now India has created a Silicon Valley startups ecosystem in India for all the verticals except chemicals. So your thoughts on how to create a Silicon Valley ecosystem for the Indian chemical industry. Over to Rahul Tikku.
Thanks, Praveen. Appreciate the time, and I also appreciate the presence of many august and eminent speakers in this forum today. I have to confess, I'm not a doctor. I don't have doctorate, but I will try to stay as innovative as possible in my communication. So bear with me for a second. I'm a businessman, but I'll just try. I'm a very passionate, innovative businessman. So I'll just try to give a flavor of innovation to it from where our previous speakers have talked about. But before I do that, let me just start with a piece of hope and couple of statements. Dr. Kandal and others have already mentioned a vast opportunity that India is going to unlock in coming years and days. But what is very important also here is that we have a very robust foundation which has been built over the years and is being currently built in India around the chemical landscape. And this will enable innovative solutions to some of the India's hardest problems that have been just discussed by some of the members. I strongly believe that for players in the region, especially in India, scale will matter even more than what it mattered before, as it is the only way that will help us fortify our competitive advantage in the chemical industry. Therefore, India's appeal to potential investors will be more than just a low-cost labor. It is not a place for that kind of an arbitrage that we were used many years ago, and there were some examples already given, and I fully subscribe to that. So if the manufacturing ecosystem in the chemical industry has to get Atmanirbhar, manufacturers in India, besides a lot of infrastructural progresses that we need to make, we also need to have an innovating ecosystem to build competitive business, this large and growing market. So therefore, R&D becomes even more important. India, I think, is not going to remain an ocean of cheap products if it has to scale and be Atmanirbhar, but more importantly, also be a base which can export not cheap products, but innovative solutions at breathtaking prices or propositions. I always tend to give this one very interesting example to people, which is about Mangalyaan. We spent about $75 odd million, just correct me if that number is wrong, in our Mars orbiter mission. And you all know how much NASA spends in the same mission. But forget about NASA. There was a movie which was called Gravity that was made in US that costed more than $75 million, about $100 million to make that movie, which was fiction. And here we are talking about a reality of going into space for $74 million. So I think this is about a very nice context that I understood from Dr. Kandal today, is above the ground is where the magic in India remains. And that is also the context around startups and Silicon Valley culture in India. Now, for any innovation to pep up, setting up of the ecosystem becomes very important. And that ecosystem in a chemical parlance is about research and development centers, which will enable ramping up of local production. And there are three things which I want to state on that. One is, I strongly believe that there is a strong requirement of an industry institute partnership if we want to step up that steep change in the innovation quotient. And I think many people would say, what is the rocket science in this? This is a common sense. Tell me something new. I have been trying to find an answer for that something new for many years as well. And here is what I want to propose. I think in India, we have done some very good collaboration opportunities with organizations like UDCT, with CSIR Labs, and also with IITs. But I still believe that this ecosystem is limited, in my opinion, to a large cross-section of these small startup Silicon Valley so-called environments who have very good idea, but they want it to get incubated and grow in a way that we can create a differentiated Mangalyaans in many domains, right? And we therefore need to encourage other institutes, including these large institutes, to provide support to these industries and nurture an ecosystem of great minds to come together, and which will enable some innovation, and that innovation is basically a value that we are going to drive towards Atmanirbharta, but also towards being net exporters of some of the solutions that we will design here. And I think we require a very strong ecosystem consisting of government support, obviously, right policies, strategic frameworks, which I hope, and I've been talking about it in some associations. And most importantly, we always keep talking about what government has to do for us. I am asking what we have to do for ourselves is also equally important, which is our private industry participation in that entire ecosystem to flourish. Because when you have these great minds who are able to think, you cultivate it to a level, then it becomes easy for a company to mature that technology or the startup to do it themselves and reach or take it to a level wherein we can talk about some differentiated markets getting created in India and not just Me Too products. Okay. And the last part of my message is that the research and development performance, I think, results from the interaction of many decisions and choices. All right. And this also includes size and location of our R&D facilities. It also includes, of course, division of labor between various groups, the choices of technologies that we used in the R&D organization, the selection of people that are going to drive. And there is also a fundamental gap there where I personally believe that we need to spend little more in terms of an intellect quotient within the institutes of not only developing problem solvers, but finding in that education institutional system about people who can create a successful innovative system by identifying and recognizing the problem in the first place, and also developing an innovative mindset for these people who are walking into corporations or CSIR labs or IITs for that kind of innovation. So I think it has to be a rounded up principle. If the Silicon Valleys of chemical industry in India have to flourish. Thank you so much for that.
Thank you, Rahul, for beautifully putting your thoughts. Now I would request Mr. Vinod Parimal, Regional President, Evonik, if he can talk about R&D and sustainability. And his company is focusing on recycling of PET and energy dependence. So over to Vinod Parimal.
Thank you for this opportunity on the panel as well. And also many thanks to all the respected panelists. I'm very happy to hear the nice exchange that we're having. Very productive, I think. Certain ideas also that I could pick up off on. Just to take Mr. Rahul's, let's say, final comments, right? I think that there is quite some opportunity. It was very interesting when he compared the budget of a Hollywood picture to a great scientific endeavor and achievement by the Indian science community, right? That's really showing you where India could excel. And our approach, at least as we have discussed in several panels before, at least for Evonik, is a German chemical company, and we are based out of Essen in Germany. In case people are not aware of who Evonik are, the approach that Evonik follows as a specialty chemical company, we would like to look at something like Atmanirbhar. Also to be, okay, how do we also support India to be Atmanirbhar on some key aspects? And one of them is sustainability, right? When we look at, and then we have a discussion with several companies, some of the large petrochemical companies, for example, produce 20,000 tons of carbon dioxide, right? So how do we convert that into an opportunity, right? So, for example, we could bring certain technologies that we are slowly developing. Germany, for example, with government participation, there is a project called Reticus that Evonik works on with Siemens, where the electrolysis with water and carbon dioxide happens to produce basic chemicals. Certainly, this is something that we think we could also try to think of how do we support India and the industries here. We consider ourselves a supporter, right? But we cannot do it alone. We try to join in these kind of, let's say, endeavors. For example, PET, India has almost 2 million metric tons per annum production of or capacity of PET, which is probably one of the largest in the world, right? The recycling of PET certainly will give another dimension to the competitiveness of the industry. And we are working on which we cannot talk about here because it's not an advertising forum, but we are certainly working with several companies on this topic intensely. We also see that the energy independence, let's say, a requirement that the Indian government has put forward. So that's another form of Atmanirbharta, right? So we see that, for example, the Satat initiative, right, to produce, let's say, biogas CNG, that's really something where we have products and we are also working together with certain partners, right, to develop this further and help the Satat initiative and support it. The other example is, of course, the hydrogen economy, which the Indian government has made, let's say, a key driver as IOC. We look to also support in there, right, to take that to the next level over the next years. So there are a range of projects that Evonik continues to work on to try to support the nation's, sustainability initiatives, but also the energy independence initiatives.
Thank you, Vinod. Now I would request Professor Madhu Vinjamur from IIT Bombay, if he can talk about on the how this industry academia framework can be developed, which is beneficial for both and also provide ease of doing business, as Rahul talked about, for MSME and large companies at the same time. Large companies don't have any problems, but smaller companies, MSMEs, do have problems. So how do we create that framework? Professor Madhu Vinjamur.
So good afternoon to all panelists and attendees. So the question is, how do you create a framework for small chemical industries to work with academia? Is that the question?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Professor Madhu, there have been some feedbacks that how can institutes be run like a corporation? So if institutes are being run like a corporation, majority of our problems will get solved. That is what the industry is talking about. They can't say it, but I'm talking on behalf of the industry that if all R&D labs or IITs or different institutes, if they can be like a corporation, things become easy for everybody because everybody has a timeline, everybody has a deadline to meet. And if you can help us in doing that, that would be a great service to become our country Atmanirbhar. Over to Professor Madhu Vinjamur.
Yeah, I mean, I differ on that. I don't think universities should be run like corporations. Universities have a different, should be run in a different framework, and there is a different a goal for universities. Of course, universities have to interact with industry to improve products, to develop new technologies. But universities also have a different goals. That is to educate the population and also to do fundamental research. So industries should not be run like corporations. But having said that, I think there should be a very close connect between industry and academia. And I feel that, industries, as Professor Pandit also mentioned, that professors sitting in industry, when they get funding and they publish papers, you know, they're happy. They have no motivation to go around and ask for their innovations or processes or technologies to be adopted by industry. I think industry should be more proactive. I'll give you some statistics here. I was talking to my colleague and he did some survey, collected some data, and we found that in the US or even in European Union, 95% of the funding that comes to universities is from the government. Only 5% come from industry. And even in IIT Bombay, that number is more or less same. 5% from industry and 95% comes from government. And I'm assuming that it is true with all other Indian institutes also. So most of the research that companies, industry does outside of India is in-house. Now, that is probably not possible in India for small companies because they have their own constraints. So, and having worked with a few industries and having worked on few projects, I feel that the small industries should have a small department if they can, if not a full-fledged R&D, at least like a process engineering department, which is kind of offline, is not doing the production job, but then is focusing on improving the processes, either reducing the cost or increasing the production. Of course, there are many challenges and there are many case studies also where people have contributed, and typically chemical engineers I know have contributed in this, in a variety of industries. That is one. And then I would also, of course, there are limitations on industry. It's not that they are unaware, but I would also think that industry should have industry should have a short-term focus and a long-term focus on R&D, where the short-term focus should be this improvement of these processes, either in terms of production or reducing costs. And there should be someone from the industry side who is responsible for this. And that person should liaise with educational institutes. And most of the times, industries do give projects to institutes, but then they remain as projects. We do not know what happens later. And academicians are not trained to take their research or their ideas into the market. So there should be, as one of the panelists also suggested, there should be an ecosystem that is built such that the ideas which are developed in the institutes are taken out by the industry and then into the market. So to sum up, I would say that industry and academia should have a close connect, and industries should have devoted people who would have some short-term and long-term projects in mind and then focus on those projects and get those processes and technologies developed and implemented and take it from the development stage to the implementation stage. And this will not happen if the people who are already working in industry are entrusted with this one more responsibility. So they have to identify people who can devote full time to this and then go ahead with this. And I think that will surely help. India has a lot of talent, and many people have said that. And we can address our issues. I see that we are not focused. This is my experience. It's not that we are unaware. And people do know, whatever I'm saying is people already know. But then if you have a dedicated people working on our for close interaction between industry and academia, I think it will help.
Thank you. Thank you for your thoughts. My view was that instead of papers, if there are more patents, I think that will definitely help the industry. And my close coordination with a lot of professors, I have seen that they focus more on the papers and less on patents. So this industry needs more of patents. That's my thought, which I thought of briefly.
Yes, patents will come if industry is involved.
And yes, industry, yes. That's
what. Patents will surely come. And then, of course, if industry is involved, patents would come. At this point, I would also say that because we are talking about Atmanirbharta and self-dependence, there is one software this one of our colleagues, Professor Kannan, developed, his and his team, which has many similarities as popular software such as Aspen and HiSys. So one could simulate flow sheets with that. And they have team that trains students and also working professionals. So if anyone is interested, I think we can put them in touch with.
Thank you, sir. Now would I request Dr. Mayuk, Sir, if you can talk about how you have a very interesting statistics that you were talking to me. So if you can talk about those statistics on the R&D part and how we can leapfrog and emulate from whether the European Union example, whether the China example or the US example. And so over to Dr. Mayuk.
Yeah, thank you, Prashant. And let me first thank ICN for giving me this platform to share with very accomplished group of panelists. I will try to keep myself abreast with them. I may use a disclaimer. What I say now are my personal views and not those shared by my organization. Because some of the things I'm going to say are probably a kind of a damper to this whole discussion. I went through the Global Innovation Index 2020 made by Cornell, INSEAD and WIPO is World Intellectual Property Organization. And India has progressed on the innovation quotient from 2018 as 57 to 2020, it's come up to 48. But you look through the report and what you see is the characterizations or the categorizations are done country specific, economy specific. And you know what? India comes under the low income economy. There again, it stands third behind Vietnam and Ukraine. Now that's a sorry state of affairs. We have this Global Innovation Index is not restricted to chemicals, but this is probably an indication of the frame of mind that we have here today. My view is, why should the government come into the picture? The business of doing business should be that of the business. The government can only be a facilitator. I have come to the conclusion that a lot of these companies which are doing chemical business in India look more at the possibility that the R&D is a cost and not a business unit, which fortunately for me did not happen in my organization. And therefore we are what we are, where we are. There is the other aspect, you know, you look at the Chemical Council of Europe statistics and you find that the R&I investment versus sales is really fantastic. Of course, China always takes precedence on everything, but we are number six in RI investments and even number six in sales. Therefore, worldwide, I'm saying. And in this, I'm not including pharmaceuticals because pharmaceuticals is a different ballgame altogether. When I talk of these chemical numbers and values, I talk of minus pharma. So if you see, China has spent 11.8 billion in investments and their sales are 1,198 billion, which is constituting about 41% of the total world sales of chemicals. While India is putting probably one-tenth, it is $1.4 billion euros investment and their sale is 89 billion. So if you look at the sales to RI, we are almost half of what China is. The other three countries which are between China and India is European Union, US and Japan. So this speaks a lot. According to me, the Indian chemical industry is probably the most, business that gives their shareholders the best value. But I find that there is a yawning gap between the potential and the possibilities or what is existing. There are other factors which are making revenues or R&Ds less competitive in India. Some of them would be like the pool of personnel. We are told that this is the biggest pool of chemists and technologists available in the country. But I don't know. I mean, some of the panelists will agree with me. What is their employability quotient? therein the universities and the institutes like ICTs or IITs, they have to make their education employment friendly, so that when the students come out for the job market, they don't look at it as an alien world. They something like inculcating an entrepreneurial thinking. You know, there are so many things that are done in the chemical labs which are probably can never be done in the industry, like use of solvents, use of hazardous chemicals. These kind of things, one if one learns in the university levels, that okay, this is a possibility, but there are other possibilities. These kind of things should be brought about. And I also want to point out that maybe this title would have been better if there was the T part in the R&D, because no R&D is complete without the technology. And if you want to look at scales of operation, just research and development doesn't help. The technology has to come into picture, and only then you can look at maybe world scale capacities, which I think today India is completely lacking, barring a few. India, like Professor Kandal said, we have everything above the ground, and fortunately for a company like Fine, we are looking at green additives right from the time we were founded. So there are so many things that can be done without using, say, solvent, without using hazardous chemicals. So this is where the focus of R&D should be. I don't know, do I have my time over or?
So we will come back to you. And I think you have justified the name of the company, Fine, by giving some fine thoughts to us, which will definitely help as we move forward. So we have completed the first track. Now I will come back and ask our panelists to what we can say, speak for a minute or so. Mr. Vinod Parimal, I think he's supposed to leave at 4:30. So I'm jumping the queue and asking him, sir, how do we partner? You talk about generic pharma and catalyst. So how do we partner? So Vinod Parimal.
So how do we partner is an important question, especially considering that we have, how shall I say, a lot of synergy that could be achieved, right? There is a lot of industry cross innovation. Like I just mentioned, there have been examples where the government has partnered a chemical company on the one hand, Evonik, and I'm talking about the government in Germany, of course, and a large company like Siemens, and then said, okay, please come together and see how you can convert, you know, see how you can manage the carbon dioxide emissions, right? And then this was an idea that came from that kind of partnership. I think the government has a key role to play to put, you know, two companies together in a room, I think. But then, you know, those two companies could, if it's a fit, then certainly there are a very good cooperative discussions that can happen, and then probably some productive work can be done as well. Evonik, from its side, just to let you know, we've had partnerships with the strategic partnerships, right, with several of the major technical institutes, right. We have a research partnership agreements. We provide scholarship funds for master degree and PhD students, right. If I remember. There was also one Evonik project research fellow who was awarded the prestigious Prime Minister's Fellowship for doctoral research, right? And I think that's a really good example of how we could partner with the academia. So there's, you know, industry partnerships that the government could foster, but then also I think I really believe that private industry must then on their own initiative partner with the academia, right? That's, you know, two sides of the partnership coin, so to speak.
I hope that answers your
question.
And any learnings? If you can talk about the two.
The learning for Evonik as an organization is that India has an impressive, let's say, intellectual base. We're not just, you know, giving lip service to that, because Evonik in the end established its global and not a regional or or even an Asia Research Center. It's a global innovation center for pharmaceuticals in Mumbai, actually. And then we've continued to invest in that global research center. We generate IP from that global research center. And we then have a second global research center now for catalysts, again in the Mumbai area. And that's again a testament to how we see that there are certain core competencies within India, right? That we want to, let's say, partner with and maybe even developed for the benefit, right, of our company, but also for the country in general.
Thank you, Vinod Parimal, for your views. Thank you. Now I request Dr. Mayuk, sir, if you can talk about the skilling part of it. Would request if you can just speak for a minute or so, the skilling part of the industrial chemistry part.
Yeah.
Mayuk.
Generally, I have noticed that when a greenhorn exiting a university is good at writing reactions on papers, what needs to be also taught to him is things like stoichiometry, the art of doing things. Maybe they should be ingrained with how patents work, and because the chemical industry would like a lot of patenting, and I believe India has a very good IPR system in place. So I think this exposure is not given to neither chemists nor technologists when they come out of the institute. And these are the kind of roadmaps they should be given to give them a hint of things to come in the future when they are getting employed. So that's it.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Manoj, if you can talk about the analytical instrument market, and if R&D picks up in India, how do you see the growth? Dr. Manoj.
Yeah. Of course, yes, we can see the very exponential growth over here. And Agilent definitely will like to be a partner with these companies. Wherever there will be a kind of a setup for the R&D, we will be there. We will be happy to be partnered with Indian industries as well as with the government agencies to develop a new products or maybe the collaborative projects. So yes, we will be very much open. If you have any kind of a collaboration or any kind of R&D projects, we will be just happy to love it. Happy to be a partner with that.
Dr. Manoj, one question which comes to in mind is, I come from the telecom and the IT sector, and there are a lot of what we can say, pay-per-use kind of a model. Mm-hmm. So as a T&M instrument, are you also looking at a pay-per-use model? Because presently, I don't think you have that model, but can you work on those models? Because that will help industry to, what we can say, get more return on investment for whatever that they are investing.
Sure, Pravinji. We had discussion on this. So definitely, I will take this point with me, and I will also discuss with my team members, and just we can work on this also, yes.
Thank you, sir. Professor Madhu, sir, Vinjamur, sir, if you can talk about, sir, what are the futuristic things that IIT Bombay is working on so that the industry can align with? Professor Madhu, Vinjamur.
So, I can't talk about IIT Bombay, all departments, but chemical engineering department, we have six areas in which our colleagues are working. And so soft matter, process systems engineering, catalysis, so on and so forth. And some of the projects that our colleagues are working on are in also emerging areas such as artificial intelligence and machine learning and bioprocesses also. So in addition to this, they're also collaborating with industry and working. Now, you want some specifics of these or?
We just wanted to know, sir, what are the things that you are working so that the industry can come and collaborate and talk to you, and the both of them can benefit in the long run, on the short run. That's what the whole purpose of asking this particular question, sir.
Yeah, so in general, there are these six areas in which our department is focusing. Now I can list down those. One is soft matter, process systems engineering, catalysis, molecular simulations, biosystems engineering. These are the six areas in which we are working. And there are our faculty are doing many projects in these areas.
Thank you, sir. Rahul, Tiku, sir, if you can talk about your R&D focus area is on mobility, textile, comfort area, noise reduction. So have I left anything, or if you can add from your front, and how are you looking at collaboration, whether industry collaboration, R&D collaboration, say department collaboration. So how are you looking at that, sir? Because your ideas were very very encouraging for us. So that's the reason I'm asking you the second set of questions to you, sir.
So I'm glad, Praveen, you know Huntsman better than I do. So I was glad with that. So I think on a specific question that you said, so we have a global research and development center based out of Mumbai Light Hall. That's where Huntsman is based. And this is essentially the center which does not necessarily only work for India. It actually works for the globe. And the ideation process from developing, designing the architecture to delivering solutions is not specifically on the molecules that are available here, but it is essentially on the above the ground brain power that is available here in the country, which we are very proud of utilizing properly and effectively over the years. So when we talk about collaboration, we have already been collaborating with industry and academia in many fronts. And I think specifically to what you asked me last time as well, Praveen, my belief is that if we are able to create a culture and an ecosystem within these innovations that are happening in institutes, of bringing them out with the partnership of an industry so that they don't end up being patent pending documents and they just are theses, but can we really leverage these opportunities of creating a collaborative of startup, you can call, or you can call any kind of a synthesis within that cloud environment, wherein we can share these thoughts that institutes are developing, and how can organizations leverage it and bring it forward in a better practical manner. And role of institutes, of the labs across the country, is also very important from that perspective. It is not only about organizations or industries getting involved. It's also to do with how can we all play a collective part in developing this brain power, in capturing these ideas properly. And also last part is, every industry some hard pressing problems, and is it possible to collaborate with institutes like IIT, like ICT on these areas and work on collective solution? This will help two ways. One, some members already mentioned here that we need to give some practical exposure to these people who are studying. These are brilliant minds, right? But then if we are able to blend some practicality along with the academic part that they are learning, that will actually help industry as well as all of us in terms of building talent as well, and also solving the problems of tomorrow. I hope I answered.
You. No, you have beautifully answered. Thank you, Rahul. Now I would request Yogesh Joshi to give his questions for the quiz. A bit of pause from my side. Yogesh.
Thank you, Praveen. So here goes the second question for the audience, which I'm sure must be excited to, answer this as soon as possible. So my second question is, how many center of excellence does Agilent have in India? I repeat, how many center of excellence does Agilent have in India? This is a pretty simple answer. You don't need not mention the cities. We just need the number. That's it, number of centers. Thank you.
Now I would request Dr. Nagaiya, if he can talk about how we can increase patents and how do we support MSMEs? If you can be short and precise, we have already overshoot our time. We need to take also a few questions. I see in the Q&A it is 29. So if you can be short and precise, Dr. Nagaiya. Dr. Nagaiya? If you can unmute yourself, sir, Dr. Nagaiya.
Though whatever the Indian industry is taking the patents that is changing the solvents or changing the order of synthesis and this is the things. So this may be not useful. So I want what Indian industry to R&D spend and interact with the universities. So you ask for the university to change the student to serve the society, not in all sectors, including teaching. So university role or institute's role to train the good strength manpower to the Indian society. So India institute, the industry should spend some of the money to train there, because every industry there is a different, one industry is different training, another industry is different. So the industry should put for the interact with the universities, interact with the institutes. So then only it is possible. This is the collective effort, collective credit and collective responsibility. So this I wanted to say, there is patents, nobody is just simply filing. There is spending the money for, there is no meaning. Spending for the institute benefit is most important.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. Pramod Kumar, if he can talk about the present and future R&D activities at Praj Industries. Dr. Pramod?
Yes.
Sir, if you can be short and precise, sir.
Yes. As I mentioned, our focus is on renewable chemicals and materials. Renewables means feedstock is starting from sugars or gases, converting them into chemicals, mainly on the bioplastics or biodegradable plastics. That's our R&D focus. We have about 90 scientists working in our R&D center, which is a world-class center related to biotechnology. So our main focus is going to be on renewable chemicals and materials, particularly biodegradable plastics. That's our main focus going to be in coming 3-5 years. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Professor Khandal, if you can talk about, you made a very interesting remark about renewable chemicals. You also talked about how it should be, that the ministry should be renamed. So if you can talk about the priority to be given and what is the policy support that you require? Because you need policy support for this industry to move away or to shift as we move forward from petroleum to renewables.
थैंक यू प्रशांत जी. मैं दो तीन बात बोलना चाहता हूँ.
जी सर.
सबसे पहला, हमारी एजुकेशन पॉलिसी में ये कहा जाता है कि स्टूडेंट्स कमिंग आउट ऑफ यूनिवर्सिटी शुड बी इंडस्ट्री रेडी. जब तक हमारे टीचर्स इंडस्ट्री रेडी नहीं होंगे तो स्टूडेंट्स कैसे इंडस्ट्री रेडी होंगे, पहली बात.
दूसरी, आप तो सर वो दोनों तरफ रह चुके हैं.
इसीलिए बता रहा हूँ क्या करना चाहिए. दूसरी बात, हमारा करिकुलम ऐसा होना चाहिए, हम आत्मनिर्भर एक सब्जेक्ट होना चाहिए देश में हर इंडस्ट्री का. और करिकुलम ऐसा होना चाहिए, हम बात ऐसे करें कि हम स्टायरीन इंपोर्ट करते हैं और बेंजीन एक्सपोर्ट करते हैं. हम स्टायरीन क्यों नहीं बना लेते? हम सोडा ऐश की कैपेसिटी है पूरा कर नहीं पा रहे हैं, क्यों इंपोर्ट कर रहे हैं सोडा ऐश? 10 लाख टन सोडा ऐश इंपोर्ट कर रहे हैं. सी साइड है, अच्छे अच्छे प्लांट है, पेस्टिसाइड इंडस्ट्री, महंगे वाले पेस्टिसाइड खरीद रहे हैं और जो नॉर्मल पेस्टिसाइड है उनकी कैपेसिटी यूटिलाइज नहीं कर रहे. नेक्स्ट पॉइंट मेरा ये कहना है कि हम बात करते हैं सिलिकॉन वैली की, अब समय आ गया हम बात करें कार्बन वैली की. मैंने ऑलरेडी कहा, मैं दोबारा रिपीट करता हूँ, हम अंग्रेजी में पढ़े रहते हैं इसलिए इनोवेशन नहीं हो पाता. अभी नई शिक्षा नीति आई है, उसमें प्रादेशिक भाषाएं होंगी, हर प्रदेश की मराठी में बात करें, तेलुगु में बात करें, और बच्चों के साथ मिलके ओपन इनोवेशन में जाएं. अब देखिए, चाइना ने 30-35 साल पहले एक डिसीजन लिया था प्रशांत जी, और ये सब लोग सुन ले वो डिसीजन कितना इंपॉर्टेंट था. उन्होंने कहा आज के पश्चात हम यूनिवर्सिटी को, R&D इंस्टीट्यूट्स को फंड नहीं करेंगे, सपोर्ट नहीं करेंगे. आप अपना सपोर्ट खुद लो, ओवरनाइट उनकी एसएमईज एमएसएमई सब प्रॉपअप हो गई, सारी आ गई और आज चाइना नंबर वन है। पब्लिकेशन पे ध्यान ना दे, प्रोडक्ट पे टेक्नोलॉजी पे ध्यान दे, बच्चों से हमारा केमिस्ट्री का केमिकल इंजीनियरिंग का सिलेबस ये होना चाहिए कि ये प्रोडक्ट हम क्यों नहीं बना रहे। डॉक्टर कुंभार ने बहुत अच्छी बात कही, उन्होंने कहा कि हम एक्रिलिक एसिड का प्लांट अब आया बीपीसीएल का, हम क्यों नहीं एक्रिलिक एसिड पहले से बनाए, क्यों नहीं अभी भी हम कर पा रहे हैं। मैं कह रहा हूं सारा हम ये जो पराली है जलाते हैं, इसको जलाइए आप पराली को, लेकिन सारा सीओ एब्जॉर्ब करिए। किसानों की इतनी अच्छी टेक्नोलॉजी थी, वो धीरे धीरे जलाते थे स्लो बर्निंग, ताकि सीओ एब्जॉर्ब हो जाए सॉइल में और कार्बन कॉन्टेंट बढ़े। हम उनको उनको ब्लेम कर रहे हैं कि पोल्यूशन बढ़ रहा है, तो हमारे पास टेक्नोलॉजीज हैं वर्ल्ड में, वर्ल्ड क्लास टेक्नोलॉजी लेंजाटेक है हमारे पास क्लैरियंट की टेक्नोलॉजी है, टोटल है, सेपिक है, इन सबकी टेक्नोलॉजी मिला के केमिकल एंड रिन्यूएबल केमिकल की एक मिनिस्ट्री हो, गैप एरियाज आइडेंटिफाई हो, हमारी इंस्टॉल्ड कैपेसिटी जो है हम क्यों नहीं उनको यूटिलाइज कर पा रहे, उनको यूटिलाइज करने के लिए कहां टेक्नोलॉजी गैप है, ये हर आईआईटी में हर इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज में ओपन डिस्कशन हो, हर प्रोफेसर से पूछा जाए केमिकल इंजीनियरिंग के कि हम ये क्यों नहीं कर रहे, और बच्चों के साथ यही डिस्कस किया जाए। अभी मैंने ऑलमोस्ट अबाउट डजन स्टूडेंट मैंने एमटेक डिसर्टेशन के लिए ऑनलाइन स्टूडेंट्स लिए इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज से, मैंने उनसे केवल ये पूछा यार बताओ पंजाब में कितना एग्री वेस्ट है, बिलियन ऑफ टन्स ऑफ एग्री वेस्ट। प्लांट आ गया यूबीसीडी का टेक्नोलॉजी, वो इथेनॉल बनाने का लिग्नोसेलुलोसिक से, वो चलने वाला नहीं, उसके बेस पे प्लांट लगा दिया, वो प्लांट कमीशन भी नहीं हुआ। बच्चों को मैंने कहा कि माइंड लगाओ हम इसको कैसे इथेनॉल बना सकते हैं लिग्नोसेलुलोसिक से बेस्ट तरीके से। मुझे बहुत अच्छी बात लगी डॉक्टर कुमार की, और आई वुड कॉम्प्लीमेंट प्रोफेसर पंडित फॉर टॉकिंग अबाउट इंडस्ट्रियल आरएनडी। हमारे 40 इंस्टीट्यूट है सीएसआईआर के, दे शुड बी डेडिकेटेड टू रेस्पेक्टिव इंडस्ट्रीज, और ये अब कहानी बंद करनी पड़ेगी कि वी आर डूइंग फॉर आरएनडी, यू आर जो लोग टेक्नोलॉजी कर रहे हैं वो आरएनडी नहीं कर रहे, जो आरएनडी कर रहे हैं वो पढ़ा नहीं रहे, जो पढ़ा रहे हैं वो आरएनडी नहीं कर रहे। तो सबको सब मिलके करना पड़ेगा, आत्मनिर्भर, एवरीबॉडी हैज टू कंट्रीब्यूट। प्रशांत जी बहुत अच्छा आपने किया है, इसका एक कैप्सूल बना के आप नीति आयोग को भेजिए, नीति आयोग में प्रोफेसर पंडित जैसे लोग होने चाहिए, डॉक्टर कुंभार जैसे लोग होने चाहिए, इस तरीके के लोग जब बैठेंगे वहां तब डिस्कशन होगा कि देश को आत्मनिर्भर कैसे बनाया।
प्रोफेसर खंडाल यहाँ पे दो सवाल है, मैं क्योंकि आपने वो बात कर रहे थे तो एक सवाल मैंने यश ठाकरे का सोचा आपसे ले लूं। ही इज एन एमटेक इन केमिकल इंजीनियरिंग, वो पूछ रहे हैं कि क्या रिसर्च प्रोजेक्ट्स पे हम फोकस करें, और दूसरा सवाल है एक नरसिम्हन वेंकटेशन का है, वो कह रहे हैं कि इन हाउस रिसर्च वर्सेस यूनिवर्सिटी रिसर्च का क्या रेशियो है। बहुत अच्छा सवाल है सर, तो क्योंकि आप दोनों जगह रहे हैं इसलिए मैं आपसे ये सवाल
बहुत अच्छे से बताऊंगा मैं उनको। देखिए बच्चों को ये बताने का है एमटेक स्टूडेंट्स को कि टेक्नोलॉजी के स्पेशली केमिकल इंजीनियरिंग के एमटेक स्टूडेंट्स को टेक्नोलॉजी गैप कायम है। जैसे छोटी सी बात बताता हूं और ये इनको नोट कर लें, लीनियर एल्किल बेंजीन एक प्रोडक्ट है जो पेट्रोलियम रूट से आता है। लीनियर एल्किल बेंजीन कैसे बनेगा, आपको इथनी इथिलीन बनाना है और इथिलीन के साथ आपको रिएक्ट कराना है, और इथिलीन आप बजाय पेट्रोलियम रूट के लेके बनाइए आप एल्कोहल जो आपका रिन्यूएबल रिसोर्स है। आज बात हो रही है कार्बन रेनबो विच इज ग्रीन से ऊपर बढ़ के, ग्रीन से ब्लू विच इज मैरीन, और उससे भी ऊपर पर्पल, जिससे जितना CO2 हमने निकाल दिया एटमॉस्फेयर में उसको कैसे एब्जॉर्ब करें। आज एमटेक केमिकल इंजीनियरिंग के स्टूडेंट्स किस में काम करते हैं, सॉफ्टवेयर में, ये डेवलप कर लिया वो डेवलप, इससे नहीं चलेगा। लेट अस फोकस ऑन समथिंग विच इज कार्बन कैप्चर, एंड कार्बन कैप्चर इन अ मैनर टू हैव केमिकल्स विच आर कॉल्ड पर्पल केमिकल। अभी ग्रीन का नहीं है, अभी पर्पल कार्बन है, इसलिए मैंने कहा कार्बन वैली बनाओ इंडिया में, और ये लोग अटैच हो जाए इंडस्ट्री के साथ, छोटे छोटे मॉलिक्यूल हम बनाए। मैं बता रहा हूँ पेंटा एरिथ्रिटोल हम एक्सपोर्ट करते हैं, हम क्यों नहीं पूरा पेंटा एरिथ्रिटोल में नंबर वन हो जाए। टर्की एक छोटा सा देश टिल द अदर डे वॉज नॉट मैन्युफैक्चरिंग सोडा एश, इज एक्सपोर्टिंग सोडा एश टू इंडिया। अब इंडिया उस पर वो ड्यूटी लगा रहा है कि भाई हमारे आ जाए डंपिंग एंटी डंपिंग। 10 लाख टन सोडा एश हम इम्पोर्ट कर रहे हैं, हम मेलामीन इम्पोर्ट कर रहे हैं। वाई अभी प्लांट आया गुजरात में 40,000 टन का, Why should we be doing this small molecules? हम methanol economy पर focus करें। आप मुझे बताइए हम slow burning का जो agri waste है उसको burn करके methanol produce करें, मिथेनॉल से हम फॉर्मेल्डिहाइड बनाए, मिथेनॉल से हम सारे जितने भी मिथेनॉल इकोनॉमी ग्लोबल इकोनॉमी बना रहे, व्हाई डोंट वी डू, वी शुड बी द नंबर वन। हमारे यहाँ सारी क्रॉप है, ऊपर से लेके जैसे सारे हमारे वेदर हैं, सारे और सारे तगड़े हमारे इंजीनियर हैं, इतने बड़े बड़े प्रोफेसर, इतने बड़े बड़े टेक्नोलॉजिस्ट। मेरा यही कहना है केमिकल इंजीनियर से, एक तो ये पार्टीशन अलग करें कि आप केमिस्ट हो, आप केमिकल इंजीनियर हो, सब लोग चर्चा करें कि देश को क्या चाहिए। अभी कोविड आया तो सब लोग लग गए कि भाई वेंटिलेटर बनाओ, ये बनाओ, वो बनाओ, ऐसे ही आत्मनिर्भर के लिए सब लोग लग जाएं और आत्मनिर्भर बनाने में क्या क्या आवश्यक है सब मिलके उस पर काम करें।
थैंक यू सर। आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट Professor Pandit, if he can talk about, there have been talks about creation of R&D fund and developing that institutional framework. So if you can talk about that, sir.
I think before I talk about that, I would just like to state three things.
Okay, sir.
Which addresses all that has been discussed. There should be a training within the institute, especially Chemical Engineering Institute, and make the scientist understand the difference between a laboratory technique and a technology. What are the steps which are involved in converting technique into technology? What are the steps? What are the financial aspects? So on and so forth, that needs to be taught to them. So that will change their language when they talk to the industry. Second is when industry is talking to the academician, please try to understand the fact that they are in academics by choice, and they are in academics by choice because they require that space and they require that freedom. So running an R&D organization like a corporate is not at all a good idea. But at the same time, as I said in the beginning, accountability should be there. Accountability has to be there. And the third aspect, which you talked about forming a framework, it is possible for us to combine the common problems, and a solution to that particular problem is not likely to be beneficial to one industry. It may be beneficial to multiple industries, and they may be competitive, they may not be competitive. It depends upon how effectively they utilize and how fast they implement that particular solution. So it is every possible opportunity the industry should come together through this seminars like this, identify and list out the problems which are there, and then offer these particular problems to the academic institute. And then academic institutes also, the faculty should come together, form a pool, which is exactly what China did, form a pool and try to solve a problem. Once the problem is solved, keeping into mind the issue of sustainability and exergy analysis, it will help the industry to come together and get the benefits. And the more benefits they get, they will find that they would have more and more interaction. And final point is the industry should devise a timeline which is mutually acceptable to academics as well as industry. Industry devises a timeline which is based on the corporate world, that is every corporate every 3 months has to show the changes in the bottom line, see how the bottom line has improved. Now that kind of an activity is not going to be acceptable to the academic institute because they are in academics because of different priorities. And finally, the last point which I would like to make, I don't know, I might have said it earlier also, but up to about 100 crores, the industry is driven by technocrats. From 100 to 500 crores, it's driven by marketing people. And once it exceeds a turnover of 500 crores, it is completely controlled by finance. This particular attitude needs to be changed for us to become Atmanirbhar. This is where I would like to rest my case.
Sir, you have beautifully summed it up for us. And I think all our panelists and the delegates will feel happy that that what you have done is, in three topics that you talked about, you have everything. Sir, questions which I would request you to take. One is from Mr. Subhas Tandon, and you have filed a lot of patents. He's talking about commercializing patents. That's one aspect of it. And I don't know whether you would be answering this. Harsh Darji is talking about scenario of CO2 capture and utilization of and utilization in India right now. So if you can talk about these two.
I can talk about both. I think, sir. even though patenting mechanism exists and it is taught to a certain extent in the academic institutes, commercialization of the patent is totally absent. The kind of a skill set which is required for you to sell a patent, to license the patent, is totally absent. And you will find that making a patent is not worth it because it's extremely expensive. And that's why people prefer a cheaper route, which is a publishing route. Once you make a patent, then to maintain the patent, to license the patent, it's a completely different ballgame. And there should be a mechanism by which the patent can be marketed, patent can be licensed out, which will start generating a revenue. The second question which you talked about was related to CO2 capture. Now, there are so many people working on CO2 capture, so many techniques are available, but not one technique has shown the extent of economic viability. I totally agree with Dr. Kandel that in initial stages, and also with Dr. Kumbhar, that initially you can't really compare it with the current cost of the chemicals which are available if you are going to change the source of the raw material. Here we are talking about dealing with extremely low concentrations, then converting it, catalyst development, so on and so forth. So initially, for carbon capture technologies to become popular, a carbon tax which is collected globally, this carbon tax can be utilized for converting these carbon capturing techniques into technologies, and a viability gap funding should be provided for these promising technologies. But to develop and identify this as a promising technology, the scientist who's working on this particular technology or technique should keep in mind all the time that every step which he takes, how it is going to affect the bottom line.
Thank you, sir. I would request Yogesh to fire his...
I think Professor Kandel, Dr. Kandel has to say something.
Yeah, yeah, bole sir, Professor Kandel.
There was a point about CO2 capture.
Yes, sir.
Why I say this? Because I think all our students and teachers must know this. The first plant for CO2 capture of industrial scale came up in China, and the technology of LanzaTech. And first time in India, we have just imported 500 tons of that ethanol, which is made from CO2 capture. And that we are going to convert in purple surfactants. But the point I'm saying is
CO capture, if I'm not with LanzaTech.
Yeah, LanzaTech,
carbon monoxide capture, it's the same thing.
Because it's the same thing from the emission. Now the same is coming, one plant in Panipat refinery, IOC refinery. Because you can't capture CO2 as such, you reduce and then make it CO and capture that. IOC refinery, Panipat, is the first plant CO2 capture, which is coming with LanzaTech. Attached with this is the technology of Clariant, where you convert the lignocellulosic into ethanol. But ethanol is a byproduct, it's not a main product. All other products are the... Yeah. This is what I mean.
SAIL also is coming up to treat the coke oven gases.
Absolutely.
To convert it to ethanol.
Thank you. Yogesh, please fire your questions.
Thank you, Praveen. So I'll be very short and sweet on my third question. So the question goes like this. Who won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in the year 2020? So this was announced last month only, I believe. And the biggest clue around this answer is these are two ladies primarily who has won the award jointly. My question is again repeated. Who won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 2020? Please shoot your answers, please, in the chat window only. Moving on to the next question in the interest of time. So this is similar to what Dr. Kandel, spoke about having a new ministry, which should include, all these key elements of the chemical and petrochemical together. The question goes like, what is the full form of MOPNG? And the clue is, this is the ministry which was under the government of India. And the question repeated again is MOPNG. This is the short form of a ministry. Off to you.
Thank you, Yogesh. There was two. There was a question from Mr. Sushant Kundu. Exploration of seaweed as a source of raw material, and I would request Dr. Pramod Kumar if you can answer this, sir. Exploration of seaweed as a source of raw material for different biochemical products.
The seaweed to biochemical production has been talked about a lot, but I don't think there are few examples where the seaweed is converted into biochemicals, but those are mainly on the nutraceutical sides. With the basically a cultivation and further processing of that. So that's the major challenge on the seaweed side, where it contains a lot of water along with chemicals, and you need to find the particular chemical. The production of that particular chemical is very small amounts. You have to extract it from that seaweed. So that's the basic issue with that.
And one question, sir, is from Reena Srijit. She is asking about, is it possible to manufacture acrylic acids and acrylates through sustainable sources?
Yes, there are few technologies that are being talked about. There was maybe 7, 8 years back, Procter & Gamble had developed technology of making acrylic acid from lactic acid, which comes from, of course, sugars to lactic acid plant. Unfortunately, it did not move forward, but recently the whole technology was bought by Cargill from Procter & Gamble to take it further. That's one way of converting lactic acid to acrylic acid, which is taking a good shape now. Whether it's commercial is another point.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Khandal, there is a question for you. Gas to chemicals and house.
See, it is very simple. First of all, I want to tell the scientists working on gas to chemical, they must remember everything that is renewable, we should not try to convert into chemical. Because there is we have 130 crores. So we cannot afford to have a competition between food versus chemical or food versus fuel. So we have to be very careful. This I tell to all the people who develop technology. For example, when they go for converting lignocellulose into ethanol, I always tell them, for God's sake, don't take this sugarcane bagasse as your feedstock. Because sugarcane bagasse is anyway burnt in the sugar industry there itself. So if you lift that and get it for converting into alcohol, you will never be able to succeed. What you have to do is you have to take the agri waste. Remember, the Jatropha oil is the perfect example of telling our student not to get into the trap of this. Dr. Kalam said that we should grow Jatropha oil because we have a lot of free land unirrigated. Ultimately, we found it is impossible. It's a good idea on paper, but actually it will not happen. So please focus on converting chemicals from agri waste only where the agri waste is real waste. Like the one which is 2 inch above the ground left from the straw of rice or of wheat. Otherwise, rest of it, for European, it is a waste. For us, it is a fodder for the cows and buffaloes. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Mayuk, there is a question. It talks about why we cannot stop our research in our country. He's talking about brain drain. I don't think we will be able to stop that, but any answer to it?
But this is a general scenario. I mean, it's not just restricted to chemistry. I mean, there is a brain drain in other sectors also. But I'm happy to observe that these things are changing slowly, but very encouragingly. There is a reverse drain happening as far as I can see. I know so many people who have come back and they are contributing their professional skills to this country. So that's it. I mean, those people have to go, but those who have to come will come back. I was one of them. I was abroad for a couple of years, but I preferred to come back and do my bit as much as I could as a profession.
There is a question from
Prashant ji. Brain drain pe main chota sa nivedan hai mera. Brain drain pe. और इसके ऊपर मेरे बहुत स्ट्रॉन्ग व्यूज है, मैं जस्ट एक सेकंड लूंगा आपका. सी वी डू नॉट मैन्युफैक्चर मेनी ऑफ द थिंग्स विच अदर कंट्रीज आर मैन्युफैक्चरिंग सेलिंग इट. वी ओनली मैन्युफैक्चर ह्यूमन बीइंग्स. वी आर नंबर वन इन द वर्ल्ड मैन्युफैक्चरिंग ग्रेट ब्रेनी ह्यूमन बीइंग्स. वी शुड एक्सपोर्ट देम एज मच एज पॉसिबल. द ह्यूमन रिसोर्स डेवलपमेंट मिनिस्ट्री शुड हैव टारगेट ऑफ एक्सपोर्टिंग अवर ह्यूमन बीइंग्स to outside the world to rule them, teach them, educate them. So brain drain is not an issue with India.
Okay, sir. There is a question. I don't know who will be able to answer this. For raw product like acrylic acid, how do we start and whom to approach?
I really don't know. Acrylic acid is first of all not a raw product. Acrylic acid is a base material, which is valuable base material. And all sorts of, I mean, starting from fiber to all sorts of chemicals, you manufacture by using acrylic acid. So there are thousands of chemicals which are based on acrylic itself, basic raw material. We should have made it longer.
There is an anonymous attendee who has asked, is it economical to produce LAB from waste plastic?
Actually, waste plastic, we have talked about it a lot. We try to make, I have an opinion that waste plastic should only be converted into process engineered fuel rather than we try to convert it into LAB or anything else. We should go for carbon valley concept. We should make LAB, our focus should be make LAB from renewable resource, from the agri waste. And the SABIC has got a technology in which they use the ethylene coming from green root and then they make LAB.
There is a question from Yash Thakre. Why micro reactors are not being extensively used, even though many research has taken place. Why micro reactors are not being extensively used, even though many research have taken place?
See, we are at a stage, if you permit me to answer, we are at a stage number 6 in the world for chemical products manufacturing. And if you compare with China, we are, I think, 1/100th of so. For us to be able to, at this time, prioritize things, what Tikuji said is right, that we should prioritize. And this is what one of the panelists also said. I think we should try to prioritize which areas we should work on it. At the moment, I do not see micro reactors as a priority. At the moment is whatever we are importing, paying through nose, we should be able to do it locally. And utilize our own local resources, our local resources, both the human resource as well as raw materials.
I think it was great having such a wonderful panel, and we were able to take a majority of the questions which were put to us. A big thanks to all our panelists. And before I sign off, I was able to, as I rightly said. So some of the things which I said that I will come up with those 10 pointers. I liked what Professor Khandal talked about renaming the industry. If you rename the industry, then renewable will come to the forefront. I also liked the second point by Professor Pandit when he talked about funding is not prioritized and accountability needs to be there. This is a very good thought. Then Dr. Pramod talked about all chemicals need to be manufactured. And we, from a 2% R&D that we are having, and a very interesting statistics was also put by one of our panelists, where he talked about, where he gave a China and an India example in terms of how much we are investing and what is the revenue that we are getting and what China is investing and how much their revenues are. So I think it is a direct correlation between R&D and sales. So I think it was wonderful talking to everybody, and I was able to come up with these points based on what you have said, and I was just trying to sum it up. Let me thank all my speakers. for spending their valuable time for this webinar. I would also like to thank my partner, Agilent, for their support. I would also like to thank all my delegates who have logged in from India and outside India for being part of this interactive e-conference. And I hope everybody got valuable inputs on how India will accelerate their growth story through R&D. As mentioned, Atmanirbhar Bharat series of the next event will be on role of PSUs to make chemical industry Atmanirbhar on November 27, 2020. Before I sign off, I would request Yogesh if he can talk about the name of the winners.
Yeah, thank you, Praveen. So another last minute twist in the overall format. We have a last question, which is specifically for our esteemed speakers, because we don't want them also to be, you know, left out of this exciting initiative. So the question goes like this, and you guys need to type on the screen on the audio chat windows. The question is, recently there was an announcement by our Honorable Finance Minister, Mrs. Sitaramanji, Nirmala Sitaramanji, on an allocation of a certain amount of fund for Atmanirbhar Bharat program. So you guys amount under this particular Ministry of Finance. Your time related to Mukesh Ambani ji, chairman and managing director of BE degree in chemical engineering, the earlier UDCT, now it is ICT Mumbai, Institute of Chemical Technology. And the winner for this particular category is Mr. Chandrasekhar Subramaniam. He is from CPMA, which is Chemical and Petrochemicals Manufacturers Association. So huge round of applause for Mr. Chandrasekhar Subramaniam from CPMA. Moving to the next question, second question was, how many center of excellence does Agilent have in India? So the correct answer is the total number of centers are three. One is Mumbai, other one is Bangalore, and third one is in Manesar.
Manesar, yeah.
And the winner for this particular answer is Anuj Mittal, lead scientist, Huntsman. Again, congratulations to Mr. Anuj Mittal. Third question was, who won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 2020? The winner for this particular question is Mr. Surya Prakash Shukla. He is a student from BITS Pilani. Again, huge round of applause for Mr. Surya Prakash Shukla, a young bright student from BITS Pilani. Fourth question was, what is the full form of MOPNG? So the full form is Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas. And the correct answer again is given by Mr. Saurabh Tripathi from Sanmar Group. Huge round of applause for Mr. Saurabh Tripathi. Incidentally, he seems to be the lucky winner for last time as well. He had won the lucky prize last in the last session as well. And this time again, he is the winner. So coming to the last question of the day, which was for the speakers. And the lucky winner is Dr. Manoj Suwade.
20 lakh crore. Yeah.
From Technologies. Yeah, 20 lakh crores.
So congratulations, Manoj. So once again, I would like to thank all my winners, all my speakers for taking time out. I know they have a very busy schedule, whether they are from the academic side, whether they are from the R&D side, whether they are from the industry side. I would really like to thank from the bottom of my heart to what come and speak so fluently as well as transparently to make this country Atmanirbhar. I think we are trying to even extend this Atmanirbhar Bharat Chemical series with new set of concepts that we will be coming in the month of November, which we will be informing you as we move forward. As I rightly said, November 27 is for the PSUs. So would request if you can connect me at 9899004608 or praveen@indianchemicalnews.com by giving us your valuable feedback for speaker participation. With respect to branding opportunities, you can talk to Yogesh.
Yeah, thanks, Praveen. So also, you know, opening the surprise for the lucky, the disclosing the prize, what we are in planning to, you know, offer against the winners, which have been declared today. So it's an Amazon gift voucher worth 1,000 rupees, which we will mail it to all the winners via email and also WhatsApp it by tomorrow.
थैंक यू. सो थैंक यू वंस अगेन. वी हैड ए वंडरफुल टाइम. और सभी को नमस्ते हमारी तरफ से, ICN की तरफ से. और हैप्पी दिवाली सर टू ऑल आवर स्पीकर्स एंड डेलीगेट्स. एंड हैप्पी दिवाली ऑल्सो फ्रॉम योगेश.
हैप्पी दिवाली.
एंड
दिस
इज प्रवीण.
हैप्पी दिवाली टू ऑल.
एंड वी विल मीट यू लाइव नेक्स्ट ई कॉन्फ्रेंस ऑन नवंबर 27 at 3 p.m.